Very good. Everything God created is good.
And you say, yeah, but what about the devil? The devil was an angel, created good. Very good. How did evil come into the universe? Evil came into the universe through the abuse of free will. Evil came into the universe through pride, which resulted in disobedience, which ultimately resulted in death. Physical death for human beings, suffering, pain, and ultimately that second death, which the book of Revelation talks about, hell. So, creation, and then the fall of angels, the fall of men, original sin, personal sin, all these things are realities. They are part of the doctrine of the faith. And then we had the incarnation, Jesus, the eternal Word, the second person of the Blessed Trinity, assumed a human nature, became like one of us, and everything except sin. The incarnation, the Word becomes flesh and dwells among us. Jesus then takes his human nature, through his human nature suffers for us, dies for us, and rises on the third day for us. Dying, he destroys our death. Rising, he restores our life. That's the victory. That's the victory in this immortal combat. All right, the crux of this, the essence of this war, this combat, the victory, we know the last chapter of the book. We win, okay? That's the victory, and the victory is brought about by Jesus Christ alone, his passion, death, and resurrection. But he wills to incorporate us as members of his mystical body in that great victory. And so we win because we are in Christ. To the degree that you become one with Jesus Christ, you have power to win this immortal combat. We spoke about healing and deliverance last evening. We are wounded. All of us are wounded in one way or another, in some way or another, at one time or another, to some degree or another. We are wounded. We may have physical ailments. We may have emotional ailments, some of them not serious. All of us feel emotional pain, loss of a loved one, anxieties at times. Doesn't mean you have a serious emotional problem, but emotions are a normal thing for human beings. But some people do have more serious emotional ailments. They suffer very much from these things. Moral ailments, that's called sin, moral problems. The world is inundated with a veritable tidal wave of sin. It touches all of us in one way or another. Sin wounds us. Even when we repent, the guilt is removed. For us Catholics, we go to confession, we receive absolution. The sin is removed, or the guilt is removed, but what remains is woundedness. The effects of sin, woundedness. We have to be very careful that we don't be instruments used to wound each other. St. James said, the tongue is a mighty weapon. We do more damage with our big mouth sometimes than, you know, and all of us have done it at one time or another. We get angry, impatient, short. We're not in a good mood someday. We tell somebody where to get off, and then they hold a grudge for the next 30 years. Oh, I've run into it continually. Somebody doesn't talk. I haven't talked to my brother-in-law for 35 years, somebody said one night. I said, well, why is that? Oh, well, the dirty so-and-so, one day he looked at me cross-eyed. Something not really much more serious than that. And I didn't talk to him for 35 years. Families alienated one from another. Woundedness. Those wounds need to be healed. The devil is real. The fallen angels are real. Now, that is a part of the doctrine of the faith. Those who cavalierly dismiss it as medieval nonsense are wrong. I don't care how many degrees in theology they have, they're even more wrong. The greater their education, the less excuse they have for being ignorant. And that's what it is, ignorance of the faith. The devil is real, the fallen angels are real, their activities are very, very real. But we must have a balanced approach when we look at these things. Don't blame the devil for all your problems. Oh, he's involved in evil, all right. But don't try to cop out and say, oh, well, the devil made me do it, or it's all his fault. Look, our fallen nature is also an enemy that we have to contend with. But very often, wounded people, especially emotionally, psychologically wounded people, become very vulnerable to the work of the enemy. And he moves in on these areas of woundedness. For instance, you may have a wound of rejection. I'll guarantee you that many a social misfit, many a criminal, many a mass murderer, at one point in time was rejected in some way. Now, you say, well, no big deal, we all experience that. Well, maybe you experienced it worse, but what happens? The devil, the demonic forces move in, grab onto that wounded area, and they exacerbate the problem. They make it worse. Imagine you get a wound, you get shot in a battle at war. You have a wound in your arm. You know, the bullet takes off part of your arm. That's a wounded area, obviously. What happens? Well, maybe germs move in, right? Maybe certain bacteria move into that wound. You get an infection, right? You get a cut or wound, you can get an infection, right? Normally, if you don't bleed to death, the cut or the wound isn't going to kill you, but the infection might. The devil moves in on those emotionally wounded areas very often, depression, anxiety. He grabs onto that wound and pushes it to an extreme. And you have extremely disturbed people. The world is filled with emotionally disturbed people, and many of them have a problem that is not merely emotional. It is emotional, but not only emotional or psychological, it is also demonic. It is not always either or. The two are not necessarily mutually exclusive. The devil is an opportunist, and very often he will move in on those emotionally wounded people. He will grab onto the wound, and he'll make it much, much worse. The infection will become serious if not treated. What do you do if you are in need of healing? What do you do if you are in need of deliverance? There are certain basic things that all of us should do. Number one, repentance. A great number of bad things that happen to people are because of sin. I remember speaking to a man. He said, everything's gone wrong in my life. I can't hold a job. My wife left me. My children won't speak to me. One thing after the next. And it seemed like a very complicated situation, and he was confused. He was very distressed. He said, what should I do? I said, the first thing you need to do is go to confession. That's the first thing an awful lot of people need to do. Go to confession. Repent. Even people who are not Catholic, who don't have the sacrament of confession, they know this. Any good Protestant will tell you this. You've got to repent. Repent. What is the first thing that Jesus said in his public ministry? He said, repent. The kingdom of God is at hand. What did St. John the Baptist do? He came preaching repentance, for the kingdom of God is at hand. What did all the prophets do? They came preaching repent, repent. That's the first step. You've got to repent, and you've got to receive God's grace. Pray. Receive the sacraments. The sacraments are the conduits of sanctifying grace. Sanctifying grace, quite simply, is a share in divine life. Now, please, and I'm going to ask St. Michael and all the angels to help me throughout the course of today, because I well know my limitation. Open your ears and listen to what I am saying, every word of it. because it is important. Repent, receive the sacraments, pray. What is a sacrament? Well, I'm going to tell you in a couple talks from now, but it's a sense perceptible sign that affects what it signifies. You say, huh? We'll go over it later, but the sacraments convey sanctifying grace. And you say, what's sanctifying grace? A share in divine life. That's all you got to know. That's simple, right? Sanctifying grace. A share in divine life. That's what it is. You want to live or die? Oh, I want to live. How'd you like to live forever? Oh, yeah. I'd love to live forever. What do you need? Sanctifying grace. Where do you get it? The sacraments. How do you receive the infinite grace that's made available through the sacraments? It depends upon your disposition. Things are received according to the disposition of the receiver. In other words, to the degree you're open, you receive. All right, now the sacraments, theologians know, all priests know, the sacraments operate by their own power. Ex opere operato. They operate by their own power, independent of the disposition of the receiver, independent of the holiness of the minister of the sacrament. The sacraments operate by their own power. They always forget to add the second part of that Latin axiom, ex opere operato, obitiam non ponentibus, if you do not posit an obstacle. The sacraments operate by their own power if you don't place an obstacle. What's the obstacle? Sin. That's the obstacle. Sin. That concerns the disposition of the one receiving. So you receive greater or less sanctifying grace dependent upon your personal disposition. And that is a function of prayer. That is a function of penance. That is a function of the exercise of virtue in your life. In other words, you get what you're ready to get, and that's all you get, and you don't get no more. Very, very simple. I was once explaining that down in Florida when I was preaching, and I was saying how we need to repent and this and that. And at one point, a man in a fervor of spirit leaped to his feet, and he began to shout out, "Thanks be to God for Father Carapi, the Roto-Rooter of my soul." I've never had a compliment quite like it since or before. Actually, he was very insightful. He said, the preaching of the Word of God, when we preach this message of repentance, which is the church's message, that's what Jesus said. That's what all the prophets said. It must be important. Repent. What happened? When we preach that message of truth, it has a way of clearing out the junk. It has a way of opening our hearts, getting rid of the junk, the sin in our hearts and in our minds that is an obstacle to grace, like Roto-Rooter. Right? You know, it clears out those obstacles. Out where I live, it doesn't rain for 6 months of the year. We have a big drought going on right now in California. You have one, I guess, kind of around here too, right? The Great Lakes have problem, not as much water as there should be. Well, out in California, everything has to be irrigated. Now, we have probably the biggest agricultural place in the whole world, in the Sacramento Valley. It's very, very rich, but it's all irrigated. If you don't bring water in, there's nothing grows. You know, no water, no life. Sanctifying grace is like water. You need it for life. They use aqueducts and irrigation ditches to bring the water in. Now imagine if one of those aqueducts was filled up with sediment and it choked off the passageway. So the water couldn't flow through and the fields weren't irrigated. What would happen? They'd dry up and die. Well, that's what happens to us. If we have the passageways, the conduits, the aqueducts of grace, if they're choked off and we don't receive the grace that's made available to us, we wither up and we spiritually die. And so we need the sacraments, we need to pray, we need the sacramentals. Many times I have prayed with individual people for healing and for deliverance. I'm not known for that. That is not my thing. That's not what I do. There are some priests who have healing ministries, and they have a charism of healing. I don't. I have raised the dead, though. Did you know that? Oh, many times. I'll bet you a lot more people would have come if they knew Father Crappie can raise the dead. Right? Oh, you didn't know that, huh? Oh, yeah. Many a morally dead person has walked into my confessional, and every one of them walked out alive. That's raising the dead. Any priest can do that. All right, so that's a little bit of a recap. Now, this third conference this morning, the essence of it is going to be on humility. That is a nuclear weapon, so to speak, in this immortal combat. Humility, the gem casket of all the virtues, some of the saints have called it. Let me read to you from St. Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 2, verse 1 and following. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any incentive of love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfishness or conceit, but in humility count others better than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God something to be grasped at. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in the heavens, on the earth, and under the earth, and every tongue proclaim to the glory of God the Father, Jesus Christ is Lord. Humility is a godly thing. Let me repeat that. Humility is a godly thing. Now there is a thought for you. God is humble. Who has less reason to be humble than anyone? God. Yet God is humble. Is Jesus Christ God? You know, I ask you the theological question. Is the Lord Jesus Christ divine? Yes, of course he is. He's the Son of God. He's the second person of the Blessed Trinity. Is Jesus Lord? You bet. He is a divine person. Is Jesus humble? Well, it just says so. The Word of God says so. Jesus humbled himself. Is God therefore humble? You better believe it. God is humble. Then how come we're not? Well, that's not God's fault. You remember how I related to you from the third chapter of the book of Genesis how the fall came about? You remember before that, the fall of angels. How did it come about? Pride. Now, please understand me. Some people could misunderstand. I am not talking about, you know, in English we have one word, and very often that one word represents several words in other languages which transmit very distinct significations and meaning, like love. Three words for love, actually four, but three main words for love in the New Testament, in Koine Greek. We only have one. In English, I say, I love Michigan. I love my dog, Sage. I love Polish sausage. You know, I love my brothers and sisters. I love God. We have one word in English, but there are variations in meaning. There are differences in the meanings and significations. in each of those cases. Well, now humility, same thing. And pride, the same thing. If, you know, pride in your family is not a bad thing. You know, well, I take pride in my work. Is that bad? No, that's not bad. You know, you care about your work. You know, the men who produce the videos and audios, should they take pride in their work? Sure they should. Should they do a good job? Absolutely. You know what a Christian does? He does everything well. Why? Because everything we do for the Lord. And that's the way you have to think. Catholics and Christians should be the best artisans, the best workers, the best professionals of anybody. Not out of love for money, out of love for God. Who are you doing it for anyway? If you're not doing it for the Lord, maybe you're doing it for the wrong reason, and that's maybe why you're not so good at it. Think about it. My husband's awful hard to get along with, you know. Why do you love him? Oh, well, I don't know. Do you love him because you see Jesus in him? Well, it's pretty hard sometimes. Yeah, but is he made in the image and likeness of God? Yes. Why do you love him? Out of love for God, that's why. That's first and foremost. You love God above all things. You've got to see God in everybody. That's what Mother Teresa of Calcutta taught us, to be able to see Jesus, even in the poorest of the poor. You do a good job out of love for God, first, and out of love for your neighbor, second. You know, I always tell people, put God first. Put everybody else second, and put you last. You know what happens then? The fulfillment of a promise. That's what happens. The last become first. And don't you forget it. You put God first. You put everybody else second. You put yourself last. What does that mean? That translates into this. Jesus says, I have come to serve, not to be served. Humility strikes at the very roots of evil. Humility is the absolute offset, the antidote, the counterattack, the weapon that strikes right at the root of evil. And what is the root of evil? Pride. Now, it doesn't mean that healthy pride that I just talked about. Pride in your family, pride in work. No, it's another word, hubris in Greek. Arrogance. Self-centered pride. It is that pride which seeks to exalt the creature above the creator. What is humility? Humility, in fact, is the acknowledgement of truth. Do you remember how evil entered the universe? It was through a lie, right? Remember I explained that to you last evening. You can be like God, the liar and father of lies said, the devil. You can be like God. If only you will disobey God, you'll become gods, deciding for yourself what is good and evil. Arrogance. That self-centeredness that exalts the creature above the creator, that resulted in disobedience to God, which brought into existence all evil. God did not create evil. God did not create sin and death and pain and suffering. God did not create that. We did that. Creatures did that. Angels who rebelled did that. Men who rebelled did that. God did not create anything evil. Everything God created is good, very good. It was through the abuse of free will that creatures went against God's commandments, went against his judgment. We did it to ourselves. That's where the devil came from. That's where the demons came from. That's where hell comes from, the abuse of free will. In other words, God took a chance on creatures. He wanted us to be his friends, you know? What kind of a friend would it be if it wasn't a willing friend? You know, if I wanted, let's say I was a young man and I wanted to marry some beautiful young girl and I hired a hitman to get the girl to love me, that'd be crazy, right? I mean, what kind of nonsense would that be? If you want someone to love you, it has to be free. God took a chance on us. He gave us free will. We can use it for good or for evil. We can abide in the truth or buy into a lie. So, humility strikes at the very roots of evil. Jesus, eternal Word, God, assumes a human nature. That's a very humble thing to do. Now, you know that God is all-powerful. You know that God is all-knowing, all-seeing, all-present, omnipresent. That's God. Now, think about us. I don't know about you, but I'm painfully aware of my limitations. I was invited to 4 other events for this weekend, good conferences and retreats. I'd like to be at all of them. I'm glad I'm here, but I'd like to be at all of them. I can't bilocate. I don't know how. I don't have the power. That's not my charism. That's a limitation. Cramps my style. Lord, don't you know my calendar is full? You know, how about some of these gifts where I can get around a little bit better? And I have other limitations. And sometimes my voice gives out, believe it or not. Sometimes I become very tired. Sometimes I get sick. Sometimes I lose patience. Sometimes I'm not as charitable as I need to be. I have all kinds of limitations, the limitations of a creature. God has no limitations. God is infinite in all his perfection. God can do anything he will. Now imagine that God assumes the nature of a creature. God assumes a human nature. That's the incarnation. In that sense, limits himself. Now, God himself is not constrained, but God chose to work through a human nature to effect redemption. That's a very humbling thing. St. Paul says it. Although he is in the form of God, Jesus is God. Jesus did not deem equality with God something to be grasped at. Who deemed equality with God something to be grasped at? Satan. And who after that? Adam and Eve, our first parents. And who after that? Every one of us, when we sin, because all sin has that self-centered arrogance at its cause, at its root cause. Pride, disobedience, pain, suffering, and death. Goes in that order every time. You might not be able to see it consciously, visibly, but it's there. It underlies all the evil in the world. So how does God overturn this reign of evil ushered in by pride? Through humility. Jesus humbles himself, even though he's God. He's not like the devil. He's not like our first parents. Even though he is God, he does not deem equality with God something to be grasped at, to be taken by force, to be usurped illicitly. No, he humbles himself. He humbles himself, accepting even death. The immortal, eternal God, through a human nature, experiences death. If I make the statement, God experienced death, is it a true statement? You know, some people say, no, God can't die. That's right, he can't. Divinity, God in his divinity, cannot die. Is Jesus God? Yes. Did Jesus die? Yeah. How? Through his human nature. All right? There's a principle in theology, the communication of idioms, the communicatio idiomatum, that's involved here. Jesus is a divine person. Through his human nature, he experiences death. That's why you can't say to the good Lord, you don't understand. You can't say it for any number of reasons. No, number one, God understands all things. He's the author of everything. He perfectly understands it. We're the ones who don't understand. But he understands on many levels. He understands it because he's God. But he's also been there and done that. Right? Jesus suffered. So don't tell God he doesn't understand your pain, that he's not sympathetic to it. Oh, Jesus suffered. He suffered physically, right? Jesus suffered. He was scourged at the pillar, right? Crowned with thorns. He was beaten brutally. Crucified. There's a lot of physical pain involved in that, I want to tell you. He knows all about physical pain, emotional pain. My God, why have you forsaken me? The cry from the cross. The cry from every human heart at one time or another. Jesus accepted all that. God is humble. And what about us? In this immortal combat, we must accept and use this nuclear weapon called humility. It is absolutely essential. Now, I'll make a very blatant, bold, clear statement here. No humility, no holiness. No holiness, no heaven. Got it? No humility, no heaven. That scares me. It does. You know, I mean, I preach this stuff. You know, one of the most widely distributed of all of my talks that I've ever done is the talk on humility. That has always kind of surprised me for some reason. But what it is, it shouldn't surprise me. It is a testament to your good sense. That's what it is. Because the people of God have a sense, a taste for the truth. You know what's important. You know in your heart what's really important. And that's why that particular talk, the tape, the audio, video, has been a consistent mover. I mean, it all over the country, people want that tape. Why? Because it's important. People have an intuition for that. Why? No humility, no holiness, no holiness, no heaven. And don't ever forget it. We are at war. And our battle is not against flesh and blood. Our battle is against principalities and powers, against the rulers of this present age of darkness, against the spiritual hosts of wickedness. You can't whip the devil with physical means alone. If you tell the devil, "Devil, I'm going to kick your butt because I've been lifting weights and I'm pretty strong," he will laugh at you. Once in the early days of the church, there was a great saint named Anthony of Egypt, Saint Anthony of the Desert. Saint Anthony was an anchorite, a hermit, who lived in the desert. There were many such religious hermits. They lived in solitude, in prayer, and great penance. One day, walking through the desert, St. Anthony encountered Satan. And he said to him, "Satan, wherefore goest thou?" And the devil responded, "Anthony, yes, I've been out tempting the brethren. I know about you, Anthony. I know all about you. You have a reputation for holiness. You pray constantly. You keep vigil at night. Stay up and pray." "Ha! I never sleep. And you, Anthony, are known to fast several days a week in your pursuit of perfection." "Ha! I never eat." "But Anthony, you are humble, and against your humility, I am powerless. You have beaten me, Anthony. You have beaten me." Don't ever forget that. If you want to be, and you must be, a spiritual warrior, if you want to engage effectively in this immortal combat, you must be humble. And I say to myself, and to you, talk is cheap. You know, I'm a preacher, and that's my living words, you know. But God reminds me constantly, talk is cheap, buddy. Easy to say it, hard to do it. You know why God made me a preacher? I figured it out. I know why God made me a preacher. I know why. I need it more than you do. You know? You got to listen to me just for a few hours every now and then. I got to listen to me every day. And I torture myself sometimes. Humility. Absolutely essential, a prerequisite for holiness. No humility, no holiness, no holiness, no heaven. I can't say it any more clearly than that. Now, what is it, though, you say? Okay, all right, humility is important. It says it in the Bible, Jesus humbled himself. I am a follower of Jesus Christ. He says the servant is no better than the master. He says the student should be like his teacher. And the teacher is humble. And so what is this humility? What is it? It is quite simply, and please get this, humility is the acknowledgement of truth. Humility is truth. Pride is a lie. The roots of evil, pride. The roots of good, humility. Humility is the acknowledgement of the truth. Well, what's that, the acknowledgement of the truth? Quite simply, it's the proclamation of who God is and who I am. God is God, the all-powerful one, the creator, the all-seeing, all-knowing, all-present. Without him, I can do nothing. Who am I? I'm a creature. I am a speck of dust in the cosmos. But God loves the speck. That's humility. That's the truth. Is it humility to walk around with my head bowed saying, I'm no good, I'm no good, I can't do anything, oh, I'm useless? That's not humility. That's false humility. Humility acknowledges the truth. Here's the truth. I'll speak for myself. I know what I am left to my own devices. I know where I came from. Okay? I was a drug addict, a violent man, horrible human being. Left to my own devices, that's me. If you would have seen me in the streets of Los Angeles back in the 1970s, you wouldn't have liked me very much. You definitely wouldn't have let your daughter go out with me. I'll guarantee you that. And the girls wouldn't have brought me home to mom and dad. Not proud of that, but that's the way it is. That's what I was without grace, left on my own. Now, God, in his great patience and mercy, put up with me for a long time, and through his mother's care, brought me back, gave me grace, and I do what I do. But I do it by the grace of God. Do I have a gift? Do I think I have a gift to preach? I know I do. I know I do. Listen, 10 years ago when I started, I remember a Monsignor saying to me, oh, young man, you got to be careful how you talk. Don't be so bold. Don't say those things like you say. The way you talk is inflammatory. And I remember I was kind of revved up in the spirit of zeal, and I said, oh, Monsignor, you better believe that my talk is inflammatory, because Jesus said, I've come to cast fire on the earth. And oh, how I longed that it already be ignited. You better believe that's hot talk. And they told me you won't last a year. And I said, well, okay, I'm going to make the best out of that year then. And they said, oh, the people aren't going to like you. And my mail was delivered to me in bags. 99.9% of it, totally positive. I go for years without a negative letter. And I get tens of thousands of positive ones. And some of the bishops say to me, oh, the people don't like what you say and this and that. I said, well, I'll tell you what, you put your mail bag here and I'll put mine over here. And then we'll see what the people say. Now, the people I'm concerned about are the people of God. And the people of God are the people who accept God's teaching, which has been handed down from the apostles, who got it from Jesus Christ. They handed it to their successors, the bishops, in union with the Bishop of Rome. The same teaching taught everywhere and always, the essential sacred deposit of the doctrine of the faith. I will say to any priest anywhere, if you want to be loved, and by the way, we priests are like everybody else. We like to be accepted. We want to be loved. But that can be a terrible fault. That can be a terrible deficiency. Because if you put the truth in peril because of your need of being accepted, you will not be loved. If you want to be loved, fathers, give the good people what they need, even if they don't want to hear it. They need to hear it. If you give it to them straight, unadulterated, unvitiated, unmitigated, undistorted, they will love you beyond your wildest dream. I could be busy 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, with the people of God, if I wanted to be, if I could handle it. Why? Am I doing anything odd? No. I'm only doing what the church has done from the beginning. Am I perfect at it? No. I have the same imperfections as anybody else. I'm a worse sinner than most people. I marveled a couple years ago. The ministry grew so fast through television. Literally, we're reaching millions of people. And I said to my superior one day, why is it, Father? You know, why me? Why'd God choose me to do all this work? And he didn't miss a beat. He just said, he couldn't find anybody worse. Now, there's a great wisdom in that. God chooses the weak and makes them strong in bearing witness to him. That's the word of God. And it's true. Don't say, I'm too weak. Don't say, I'm too old. And from the looks of some of you. But don't say, I'm too old. I don't care if you're 104. You're not too old. And don't say, I'm too young. And don't say, I'm not educated or this, that, the other thing. Cop-outs, nonsense. How many saints became saints without an advanced degree in theology? Almost all of them. You're called to be a saint. You're called to be holy. You're called to be a warrior in this immortal combat. You're called in Jesus, through him and with him, to set the captives free. Take up that great weapon of humility. Now, in a practical way, how does it work? Okay, Jesus says to you right here, right now, personally, you know, up close and personal, Jesus is in your face, and he says, I have come to serve, not to be served. How about you? Why are you here? Have you come to serve or to be served? Are you like me or somebody else? Whose servant are you? Serving somehow better than the master? You think you're better than me? I came to serve. Husband, is your basic principle, I've come to serve my wife. I've come to serve my children. I've come to serve everybody I come in contact with. I'm a servant. Do you know what the word is in the New Testament? It's not even servant. They kind of fancied up the word. It's slave. Doulos in Greek. Slave. Slaves do hard things and dirty things. Slaves do things nobody else wants a stoop to do. You want to be a servant of the servants of God? It can be a hard, dirty job. Can be a tough job. You know, you mothers know that sometimes, the more I do for my family, the more I do for my husband, the more I do for my children, the less I'm appreciated. You know? I worked over a hot stove all day. I prepared this meal, and you don't even care. Holy orders is kind of like marriage. When we priests are ordained, it's like a wedding. My wedding was great. I was ordained at St. Peter's Basilica. The Pope ordained me, and 10,000 people were present. That was my wedding day. Priests in the high priest, Jesus Christ, are espoused to the church, the mystical bride of Christ. So we're married, too. We're married to the church. And I was absolutely ecstatic after my wedding that I had a beautiful bride, and what a honeymoon. And then one morning I woke up, rolled over and looked and said, "Ah! What have I done?" All of a sudden my bride wasn't looking so good. She had become a thorn in my side. She was agitating me, persecuting me. The more I did, the less she appreciated it. All right, it sounds familiar. It is. We must come to serve. And what about religious? My goodness, I know so many good religious sisters, 50 years professed, some of them. Totally unheralded. Nobody seems to care. Oh, I know some of them, they taught school for 50 years. And what a beautiful, beautiful life that is. But nobody really heralds them very much. Day in and day out, they live in a very quiet, mundane world. No glory, no acclamations. And yet, in the eyes of God, how great these servants are. Priests, pastors of small parishes, far gone places, unheralded, right? Yeah. Oh, some of these priests are heroes. You have some of them here with you today. Yeah. Well, I'm telling you that in heaven, they're going to shine like the stars for all eternity. They really are. And their humility will be greatly rewarded. And so we must come to serve, not to be served. I remember the night before I was ordained, I stayed up all night before the Blessed Sacrament with the founder and general superior of my religious order, Father Jim Flanagan, and we prayed all night. And in between prayer, in front of Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament, he would talk to me like a father talks to his son, instructing me, telling me what to do and how to do it as a priest. And he's the greatest priest I know, a wonderful man, Father Jim Flanagan, still living, still very active as a priest. But much to my shame, I don't remember a thing he said that night, except this: always, always come as a servant. You will never be unhappy. You will never lose your peace, and you'll do great things if you always come as a servant. Slaves should not expect praise and thanks. Slaves have a thankless task to perform. It's merely their duty. A good friend of mine, a classmate from the seminary, Father Bill Casey, who's now Father General of the Fathers of Mercy, preached many missions, and he's a good friend of mine. And Father Bill tells me every time he preaches a mission, he'll go to the back of the church when it's all over and quiet, nobody's there. And in the words of the gospel, he'll say, "Lord, I am but a useless servant. After I've done everything as well as I could, all I can say is, Lord, I'm but a profitless servant." And that's the attitude of slaves. When you come to a wedding feast, take the lowest place, Jesus said. Don't seek to exalt yourself. If you seek to exalt yourself, you'll be humbled. Humble yourself. Take the lowest place at the wedding feast. The Lord of the wedding will invite you up closer, and he will. Humble yourself, and you will be exalted. This is a wisdom and a power far beyond the grasp of the worldly mind. If you want to be a force in this immortal combat, If you want to be a good soldier in God's army, if you want to be an instrument of healing and deliverance for your brothers and sisters who are so wounded, who are suffering throughout the world so very much, who are in the grip of the evil one, if you want to do that, and you must do that, be humble. Come as a servant. Don't be bent out of shape because somebody doesn't appreciate you. Don't be insulted because someone doesn't accept you. Don't be even insulted if the bishop doesn't like you, or if the pastor doesn't like you, or if anybody doesn't like you. Be humble. Be humble. Don't go shoot your mouth off. I mean, that's a temptation we all have from time to time. We want to lash out. You know, somebody curses us. Oh, you want to curse me? I'll show you how to curse. No. The Word of God tells us, return a curse with a blessing. Well, they give you evil, give them good. St. Francis de Sales used to say, you can catch more flies with honey than vinegar. Kill them with kindness. Oh, be humble. You'll be surprised the power of humility. Oh, not too long ago, they tried again to get rid of Mother Angelica. I was with her out on the West Coast and looked like her hour had come. And she was headed for ruin, we thought. And she said, what should I do? And without going into the details, I said, well, don't acquiesce to something you can't. Don't acknowledge an error as though it were the truth. But respectfully say, I can't do that. And take the consequences. If they're going to depose you as abbess, as was proposed, fine. If they want to remove you from the network, good. You didn't join the Poor Clares to be president of a corporation, did you? Nope. I'd love to be a simple nun. Sure. Then go ahead. Be humble. Humble yourself. Be respectful and say, I'm sorry, I can't acquiesce to that because it's evil. However, I'll accept the consequences. Humble yourself. We waited for the reply. It never came. It was a bluff. They feared her. They knew the people held her to be a prophet. So they backed off. Humility is important, but do not confuse humility with weakness. Humility is not weakness. Humility is not acquiescing to evil. Humility is the acknowledgement of the truth. I acknowledge I have gifts. But I also acknowledge where they came from. They came from God Almighty. I didn't give myself any of the gifts I have. God gave them to me. What's the only appropriate response? Thanksgiving. Thanks to God. I thank God I can breathe and see and walk and hear. I thank God for my education, and I thank God for the priesthood, and I thank God for His beautiful church and the wonderful people in that church. And I must even thank God for the humbling reality of persecution at times. For in that persecution is the seed of glory. Humble yourself under the hand of Almighty God, and in due time He will lift you up. For a little time we may have to suffer. Come as a servant. Come to your family as a servant. How can I serve you? You'll never be disappointed. You'll never be upset. You'll never lose your peace. You know, if a bad master insults his servant, abuses his servant, you know, in the old days, he's the boss. Servant has no rights. What rights do we have? We have the right. To be catechized and to be evangelized. We have a right to a decent, reverent celebration of the sacrament. Jesus said, whoever gives up father or mother, wife, brother, sister, lands for me, Oh, he will have father and mother and brothers and sisters and lands 100 times over and persecutions besides, says the Word of God. And so you give up everything to serve the Lord. You become a fool for Christ. The world laughs at you and mocks you, scoffs at you. You're considered a fool. Rejoice. Rejoice and be happy and know that in your humility, in that acknowledgement of the truth, one day when the dust settles, the smoke of battle is blown away and time gives way to eternity, you're going to stand before that God you serve and you're going to hear these words. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master's house.